Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Birthing a Movement: Midwives, Law, and the Politics of Reproductive Care by Renee Ann Cramer. Narrated by Susan Ericksen. Introduction. Knowing about legality and illegality in midwifery care in the United States. I was a sociologist before I was a midwife. It's the same, except some of us touch vaginas. Sarah, a midwife from Oklahoma, at the Midwives Alliance of North America Conference. Different bodies of knowledge are produced in different settings. Barbara Katz Rothman, a bun in the oven. We tell ourselves stories in order to live. Joan Didion. We tell ourselves stories in order to live. If you practice here, you're probably going to get prosecuted and sent to jail. I've been prosecuted criminally 3 times in South Dakota. That's how Gina describes her 30 years working as an outlaw midwife from an illegal state. In early June 2007, I drove a dusty dirt road east and north across the South Dakota border, a few miles into Minnesota, and down a quarter-mile driveway past horses, cows, and goats to Gina's small farmhouse, surrounded by several outbuildings and a neat-as-a-pin yard. The home was no different from dozens of similar 100-acre plots in the rural southwestern Minnesota countryside. This uniformity benefited Gina, who has attended more than 600 births and trained at least a dozen apprentices. She used this farmhouse as a safe house and site of practice. In 2007, she operated across state lines to keep herself out of jail. When I drove up that summer day, a visibly pregnant woman was getting into the passenger seat of a waiting car. Gina waved goodbye to her before she greeted me, and we walked to the small 2-room outbuilding that was meticulously arranged for her midwifery practice. In the late 1990s, in Yankton, South Dakota, Gina first went to trial, charged with practicing without a license. Gina had previously trained as a certified nurse midwife, CNM, but was practicing as a direct entry or lay midwife, an unlicensed midwife who has become skilled through a mix of apprenticeship and book learning. "They found me not guilty," Gina tells me about those charges in the 90s. This wasn't the end of her legal trouble, though. After the jury's not guilty verdict, the state successfully sought an injunction against her midwifery practice. At this point in our conversation, Gina opened a folder to show me the cease and desist order she received from the state, an order that she continued to violate. "This one says I can't practice as a CNM without a license, which I don't believe I've done. But in its definition, the judge said since I've admitted to such things as providing food and fluids and putting a cold washcloth on the forehead and pressure to the lower back and hot, moist pads, and a few more midwifery kind of things, like listening to fetal heart tones, or prenatal massage or cutting the cord. These are things that only a certified nurse midwife can do in the state of South Dakota." And I thought, that is absolutely ridiculous. Gina tells me that after she received the cease and desist letter, "I'm sure that the state of South Dakota thought I had quit. But after much prayer and discernment, I continued practicing as a direct entry midwife." I had first met Gina at a South Dakota Safe Childbirth Options Conference in Custer, South Dakota. The event focused on the lack of access to labor and delivery care in the state, which is especially problematic for rural families living far from hospitals. During the course of an intensive weekend of workshops, I attended a session meant to prepare husbands to handle emergencies that come up during unassisted birth, as well as classes on prenatal nutrition, decisions regarding vaccination, and the history of midwifery in the state. As a participant observer, I gave a lecture on the laws relating to coercive force during childbirth. While in Custer, I connected with midwives and their advocates. Each told me, "You have to interview Gina." That's how I ended up, a year later, sitting with Gina in rural Minnesota. After Gina's first acquittal, she was found guilty of violating the injunction against her practice and given a suspended sentence of 60 days in jail and a $5,000 fine. She tells me that she was scolded by the judge and told to stop her practice. But her calling was too strong, and the need for her skills too great for her to listen to the law. Women would choose to give birth with no assistance at all before going to the hospital. Such was the strength of their faith, their desire to avoid a hospital birth experience, or their distance from quality medical care. Relying on her faith, Gina reasoned that she would be there for those women, whether it was legal or not. "I wasn't sure what to do. I'm a Christian, and I love the Lord very much, and as a Christian, I can't just go out and, quote, disobey the law, you know. And here they're saying that I'm disobeying the law, which has nothing to do with what I was doing. And I didn't feel I was disobeying it, but I went to the Lord and I said, 'Lord, I've got to know why I'm doing this. Am I just doing this because I enjoy being with moms and babies? If that's the only reason, then that's not a good enough reason, and I need to stop.' And so I really prayed about it. I prayed. I fasted. I got counsel from some godly friends that I knew would understand both sides of the issue. And I just waited on the Lord for him to show me what he wanted me to do." Reading her Bible one morning, Gina tells me she read a passage that made clear to her that God had called midwives to practice with women who needed them. Feeling that this was her ministry, she continued in her practice as a direct entry midwife in the state. Shortly after this decision, Gina attended a particularly traumatic birth that culminated in the need to transport her client and baby in a blizzard and via helicopter to the regional hospital for emergency care. The baby had been born at home with shoulder dystocia and a cord wrap, and was not breathing well, but did have weak heart tones. Gina did CPR until the child could be transported and intubated. The baby lived in the NICU for several days before passing away. Gina found herself again in court, charged with practicing medicine without a license in violation of the cease and desist order. She told me, "Well, I knew I was in trouble. Not that I was doing anything wrong." She was not charged with negligence or held responsible for the child's death. Rather, she explained, "They charged me with 4 counts of practicing unlicensed midwifery, and so that's what I was convicted of. I was convicted of all 4 counts. The judge could have sentenced me to a year in jail on each of the 4 counts and $1,000 fine, but she sentenced me to 180 days in jail on each count and a $500 fine, and the prosecuting attorney wanted a reimbursement to the family for what they had paid me for the birth. And so she said I owe a $500 reimbursement to the family, and the family refused to accept that. Then she suspended all the jail time but 30 days, and so I had to pay the $2,000 fine, and I served 30 days in jail, for being a midwife in the state of South Dakota. When I asked Gina what that was like, a grandmother midwife spending 30 days in jail, she answered simply, "It was not easy." And then she laughed and told me to read her book. Gina's exhortation reaffirmed my desire as a socio-legal scholar to write my own. Birthing a Movement, Midwives, Law, and the Politics of Reproductive Care is a socio-legal story that weaves together legal pluralism, legal mobilization, legal consciousness, and legal implementation in order to better understand their constitutive interactions in the creation of professional boundaries and disciplinary knowledge. In it, I examine the multiple ways that midwives and advocates mobilize to expand access to reproductive care, as well as the seemingly contradictory impulses they have in both seeking and seeking to avoid the state. The book is also, at its core, an argument about the need for holistic, embodied, and integrative socio-legal research, and a reminder for us to take seriously the stories we tell about law in society, as those stories create spaces within which justice can flourish. Legal pluralism and the status of midwives in the United States. The legal landscape of home birth midwifery in the United States is pluralistic. I mean this first in the classical sense of legal pluralism, whereby we notice that formal, state-promulgated rules and practices exist side by side, and sometimes in tension with, traditional or folk practices that also have the normative force of law. Midwives use practices handed down through professional generations. A Gaskin maneuver to turn a breech baby, for instance, alongside law that places a breech delivery outside of their scope of practice. And, second, I use the term legal pluralism to highlight that the formal state-promulgated rules and practices are themselves pluralistic. A certified professional midwife, CPM, might have a legal and regulated practice in Oregon, but when she moves to Illinois, that same practice is no longer legal and is not regulated. Midwives in the United States participate in legal systems that Boaventura de Sousa Santos might say are typified by interlegality, and in what Sally Mary has termed the new legal pluralism. At its most elemental, this book examines and showcases the legal pluralism that governs those who attend to people who labor and deliver. These midwives go by several different designations that indicate their training, their attitudes, their scope of practice, and their legal status, many of which are determined by the laws and norms of their locale, and which might shift due to geography or politics. This pluralism necessitates that we take care to articulate a common language and understanding of who attends birth in the United States. Most births, 98%, in the United States take place in hospitals and are attended by obstetrician gynecologists, OBGYNs, and a nursing staff. OBGYNs are specialist allopathic doctors who have trained in women's reproductive health. Obstetrics is the medical practice of working with pregnant and laboring women. Gynecological practice covers the rest of women's reproductive lives, including menopause. Nurses who work labor and delivery are also specialists, focusing on labor and delivery only. They do not do whole woman health nor reproductive care outside of labor and delivery. These practitioners, OBGYNs, labor and delivery nurses, are experts in hospital birth and the medical model of care. If you labor and deliver in the United States, it is almost certain you will be in their hands. A small but increasing percentage of hospital births, around 8%, are attended by certified nurse midwives, CNMs, who also attend to prenatal care and do postnatal follow-up. CNMs are accredited by the American College of Nurse Midwives. They sit for their exams after earning their BS in nursing, achieving an RN certification, and then receiving their MS in nursing. CNMs are authorized to practice in hospitals in all 50 states and in birth centers in 37 states plus the District of Columbia. When I first interviewed Gina, CNMs in South Dakota could practice legally in hospital settings, but not at home. They gained legal status for home birth in South Dakota in 2013. CNMs may legally attend home births in all 50 states, but the vast majority of births attended by certified nurse midwives take place in the hospital, and most CNMs self-select into hospital practices. In 2014, the year of the most recently available data, 94.2% of all births attended by CNMs were hospital births, 3% occurred in freestanding birth centers, and 2.7% were home births. As of May 2015, there were 11,194 CNMs registered with the American College of Nurse Midwives, ACNM. Although the story of how CNMs gain professional prominence and legal status is fascinating and important, this book does not recount that story. Rather, this book focuses on certified professional midwives, CPMs, direct entry midwives, and their advocates. CPMs are not nurses. They operate outside of the medical model. They attend only out-of-hospital birth. In this book, I use midwife generally to refer to any person who is not a nurse midwife, but who is trained to attend during labor and delivery and to provide pre- and postnatal care. When I am writing about particular practitioners, organizations, or communities, I use the designation that they adopt to refer to themselves. Because my primary interest in this book is the fight for and over the CPM credential, most, but not all, of the midwives whom I spoke with are practicing as or aspiring to be recognized as CPMs. There are currently two paths to the training required for CPM certification by the North American Registry of Midwives, NARM. Potential CPMs must hold a high school degree or equivalent and either apply for certification through a portfolio evaluation process, PEP, or graduate from a didactic program approved by the Midwifery Education Accreditation Council, MEAC. Certification of CPMs rests on establishing competency through skills assessment and exams. Potential CPMs going through PEP must undertake clinical training or apprenticeship under the supervision of an experienced preceptor for at least 2 years. During that training, they must observe 10 births in any setting and in any capacity, assist a preceptor in 20 births, 25 prenatal exams, 20 newborn exams, and 10 postpartum visits, and serve as the primary provider, still under supervision, at 20 births, 75 prenatal exams, 20 newborn exams, and 40 postpartum visits. After accruing this experience, candidates may sit for the CPM exam. MEAC-accredited programs organize their clinical training to coincide with didactic learning. In addition to the clinical practice, MEAC applicants must take a course on cultural competency and must attend at least 2 planned hospital births. Until recently, most CPMs were achieving their competency through apprenticeship programs, and apprenticeship is the more traditional route to gaining expertise in midwifery. Increasingly, however, CPM candidates are attending MEEC-accredited schools, in part because federal student loans now cover the expenses of such programs, and because many states are beginning to condition legal status on a didactic route to certification. There are midwives who are wary of these didactic requirements. They worry that these requirements will constrain access to the profession for candidates who live far from a MEEC-accredited school or have other barriers to that education. They also worry about the loss of women's ways of knowing and transmitting knowledge when apprenticeship is no longer the primary mode of education. CPMs do not have hospital privileges in any jurisdiction. They only attend out-of-hospital birth and provide the pre- and postnatal care associated with it. They almost always practice in a client's home. Only 8% of CPMs responding to the North American Registry of Midwives' most recent job analysis survey indicated that their primary workplace is a birth center. In 2016, the most recent year for which there are data available, there were 2,069 CPMs registered with NARM and active in their profession. While the legal status for certified nurse midwives has been relatively stable since the mid-20th century, the legal status for CPMs has been contested and in flux since the mid-1970s, and especially since around the year 2000. When I started this research in 2006, 22 states licensed and regulated CPMs. 28 refused to. CPM practice was illegal in South Dakota when I interviewed Gina. It remains so until June 17, 2017. By fall 2019, 35 states licensed CPMs, and all but one of those regulates their practice. CPM practice remains illegal in 8 states, where it could bring felony convictions and penalties that include imprisonment. CPMs are unregulated, with a confused and confusing legal status in the remaining 7 states. Many of those states have active consumer and advocacy movements attempting to achieve legalization, regulation, and licensure for certified professional midwives. CNMs and CPMs have a long and sometimes contentious relationship. In some states, CNMs lobby against legalization for CPMs. But sometimes, it is a mutually beneficial relationship, and the CNMs and CPMs support each other's practices. Finally, some midwives are neither CNMs nor CPMs. Their designations vary according to state law, academic background, and personal preference. These titles include licensed midwives, lay midwives, direct entry midwives, traditional midwives, and birth attendants. These practitioners have almost always been trained through apprenticeship, though some have gone through nursing or other didactic learning programs, but do not identify as CPMs or CNMs when practicing out-of-hospital birth. Some of them desire CPM credentialing and regulation and actively advocate for their state to adopt those standards. Others eschew credentialing for religious, spiritual, or political reasons and vigorously seek to avoid the CPM credential and state involvement with their practice. Some of these midwives actively oppose legislation meant to regulate their practice and license CPMs. These disparities in legal status and nomenclature and the rapid movement toward licensure in several states can be confusing for practitioners and consumers alike. When I lived in California, I had the option of a home birth attended by a legal, licensed, and regulated CPM or CNM, or a hospital birth attended by either an OBGYN or a CNM. Now that I live in Iowa, a state that still refuses to license CPMs, I could have either an in or out of hospital birth attended by a certified nurse midwife, and I could also rather easily find a CPM, but she wouldn't be governed by any state body and could find herself charged with the felony of practicing medicine without a license. Just 4 hours north, in South Dakota, are midwives like Gina, who, until gaining legal status in the summer of 2017, might well have operated out of safe houses in bordering states to avoid cease and desist orders. 4 hours south, in Missouri, both CPMs and CNMs operate legally, but CPMs do so without regulatory governance, some in birth centers that do not comport with state ambulatory surgery center laws recently used to limit abortion providers by regulating clinic location, size, and staffing. CPMs in Missouri are also always under threat that legislators will rescind their legal status. Mapping the regulatory web that midwives operate under within various jurisdictions is partly a project of legal pluralism. In addition, understanding the distinctions in practice, self-perception, and relationship to medicine and state underscored by these designations, as well as grasping how state and medical power have contributed to this plurality, touches on legal mobilization and legal consciousness. Midwives in illegal and or unregulated states find themselves in a seemingly unsustainable situation and are often envious of their professional sisters in places where regulation and licensure are available. In those states, advocates must work on two projects simultaneously. They must convince state legislators of the legitimacy and safety of midwife-attended home birth, while also building a birth culture that will support them with a diverse set of clients who want out-of-hospital birth experiences. In legal and regulated states, midwives must also create a strong and supportive birth culture while dealing with the existence of barriers to safe practice that result in poorly integrated care and, often, poor outcomes for moms and babies. Legal mobilization on behalf of certified professional midwives. Legal mobilization scholars and the movement actors they study have long recognized that law is sometimes a strategic resource to be used instrumentally for the advancement of movement goals. Movement activists often explicitly acknowledge the instrumental use of law to be part of a multi-pronged strategy, and frequently these activists acknowledge trade-offs when they adopt legal mobilization as a technique. Individuals within marginalized groups clearly have the ability to knowingly make meaningful compromises while pursuing legal mobilization. Such mobilization holds both opportunities and constraints. Through it, activists may knowingly accept otherwise unwanted normalization or domestication of their claims in order to achieve victory. And there are frequently debates within movements and among movement activists about the decision to pursue legal mobilization at all. As well, multiple scholars of legal mobilization point in various ways to the constitutive power of law and rights claiming as a partial answer to the question of why social movement actors continue to engage with the legal system even when it might seem to fail, restrain, or limit them. When individuals within a group mobilize to use law in order to articulate a rights claim, they participate, even when they fail or when their efforts come up short, in reshaping the content of that right. Social movement actors engaged in legal mobilization often see and understand that law is constitutive of meaning and engage in a process of legal translation by which their claims are made legible to legal actors. As much recent work on CPMs evidences, midwives and their advocates have focused their mobilization efforts since the mid-1980s on seeking professional status. Their advocates have been primarily casting their cause as a consumer movement meant to expand the birth options of moms and families. While some midwives do not welcome nor want state regulation, the dominant paradigm for organizing has been to seek licensure and state recognition. Midwives and their advocates are engaged in a multi-pronged set of strategies to increase access to home birth midwifery care through expansion of CPM licensure. Their actions range from political mobilization in the form of lobbying legislators and engaging in electoral politics to social movement activities meant to change a culture of birth in a given locale through red tent events, Labor Day picnics, film screenings, and engaging the media. Some of their actions can be easily understood as legal mobilization strategies, from the defense of midwives in criminal cases to the tort actions brought by lawyers against doctors accused of obstetric violence during hospital birth. These sorts of cause lawyering activities are joined with legal mobilization that focuses not on rights, but on seeking governance through regulation and regulatory policy. Nationally and locally, midwives and advocates engage in cultural spaces ranging from alternative health fairs to hospital delivery rooms, legislative and regulatory spaces like the State House and the Medical Board, and in explicitly legal spaces like the courtroom. As Ronan Shamir has pointed out, it isn't always necessary or useful to distinguish among the various forms of legality that activists and lawmakers engage with as they create social change. He writes, "Legalization, adjudication, regulations, and enforcement are all part of the matrix of how things get done. In large part because of how they view the roles of law, the state, medicine, and midwifery, midwives get things done using a broad range of political, legal, and cultural strategies." In 2019, midwives in Kentucky and Hawaii achieved legal status. They followed on the heels of Alabama and South Dakota, Maine and Michigan, Maryland, Rhode Island, and Indiana. As I write this in 2020, there are active movements to legalize and regulate midwifery in four states and on the island of Puerto Rico. The bill to legalize midwifery in Iowa just died in subcommittee, but Illinois and Georgia still had bills pending, and advocates were cautiously optimistic. Consumers and midwives in five additional states and the District of Columbia are working toward launching reinvigorated legislative efforts. Though change takes time, midwifery advocates have had steady success in expanding access to care. Legal consciousness, activism, and practice. Midwives and their advocates have nuanced and strategic understandings of law, and their varied forms of mobilization make sense, given that their legal consciousness is multi-layered. Legal consciousness is, simply put, the ways in which people experience, understand, and act in relation to law. Legal consciousness, write Lynette Chua and David Engel, comprises both cognition and behavior, both the ideologies and the practices of people as they navigate their way through situations in which law could play a role. Scholars of legal consciousness have been interested in the ways that the Mandarin materials of legal doctrine impact legal practice and understanding. They have recognized that even those folks not mobilizing law as activists have legal experiences and conceptions of the legal, and that legal consciousness is constitutively developed and expressed through the daily lived experiences of average people. Legal anthropologists, critical race theorists, and scholars concerned with understanding indigenous knowledge and law have all grappled with the ways that common sense understandings become, reinforce, and challenge legal knowledge through processes of legal consciousness building. And scholars have recognized the need to attend to the legal consciousness of people who interact with, but do not see themselves as mobilizing, the law. Further, neoliberal governance plays an important role in reconstituting the legal consciousness of everyday and marginalized people as they engage with the regulatory power of the state. Regulatory power and the economization of that power constitutes those making claims on the state as vulnerable to being silenced and ignored once they achieve the very regulatory governance they seek. And the imposition of regulations and desire for state funding post-1980 has pushed advocacy organizations, often against their will, onto the terrain of the state. When regulatory governance is promulgated and situated within the contemporary context of neoliberalism, identities of consumer and victim gain primacy over citizen. The activism and legal consciousness around those identities is different from rights-seeking or protest-oriented activism. Within neoliberal contexts, activists' access to regulatory governance trumps seeking access to rights. Midwifery is a case in point. My fieldwork shows clearly that women advocating for midwifery care are more frequently seeking regulatory governance and access to care as consumers via legal and political mobilization, in what is certainly a shift in legal consciousness from rights claiming toward disciplinary and economic power. Though this isn't the whole story, of course. There are pockets of, as Kristen Buemiller puts it, insurgency. And as she found in her examination of the neoliberal appropriation of feminist anti-sexual violence work, women in their everyday practices are reinventing their relationship to authority. This book details those everyday practices, as well as the tensions that midwives and advocates face in seeking state regulatory power. While the implications of moving away from rights talk might seem to decenter law, such a move also proves to make pro-midwifery mobilization unique in the ways that it self-consciously and intentionally cuts across legal, political, and social movement strategies. Indeed, Bruce Hoffman's investigation of pro-midwifery movements at the state level notes that midwives and their advocates are savvy in their awareness of the dual nature of law, leveraging law's ideals in support of political ends. Activists' legal consciousness understands law as a necessary but insufficient way of achieving well-integrated care for people who are laboring and delivering. Midwives and their advocates believe that the skills, knowledge, and practices of trained out-of-hospital birth attendants constitute an authoritative knowledge that should be respected by policymakers and regulators and should be readily available to those who give birth. The goal of the pro-midwifery activism that I study is to increase access to culturally appropriate, affordable, and safe care for people who desire to labor and deliver outside of the hospital. Most midwives agree that the best way to provide this is to expand access to physiologic birth, what many call natural birth, meaning unmedicated birth not facilitated by medical technologies like continuous fetal monitoring or drugs meant to slow, augment, or numb contractions. Midwives and their advocates organize their activism around three primary issues of access. First, they understand themselves to be engaged in risk mitigation in the interests of public health achieved through regulatory governance and professionalization. Second, they see themselves as engaged in empowering people who are laboring and delivering, who seek autonomy through resistance to dominant norms of medicalized birth. And third, they seek to increase access to a wide range of reproductive care by mobilizing for reproductive justice. It is tempting to think of all of these forms of political, social, and legal mobilization as rooted in a tradition of women's movements, which are found wherever women act collectively to present public claims based on their gendered identities as women. These movements, according to Amy Mazur, Dorothy McBride, and Susan Hoard, provide a means for women, in their full cultural and ethnic complexity, to make their gender-conscious ideas public, to participate in achieving their goals, and to change public policy and the state. Often, midwives focus on the definition of midwifery as with woman, and emphasize that theirs is a profession of women for women. Some of the roots of contemporary midwifery advocacy grow from 1970s feminism in the United States, with midwives themselves referring to their work for legal status as part of the third wave of a feminist project. Similarly, most of the public receiving messages about midwives and their clients experience those messages as gendered. Birthing bodies are feminine, feminized bodies, and the lactating, lobbying bodies of women in the state houses simultaneously undermined and established the credibility of consumer activists. Though I adopt gendered language in discussing the activism and mobilization strategies at the state level, I do want to insert three cautions about considering the movement for midwifery a movement for women's rights. First, not all midwives would align themselves with what is commonly understood to be a feminist political project. Midwives and their advocates are clear in their articulation of the power and knowledge of those who labor and deliver, and clear on the problematic regulations that impact and limit decision-making of those people with regard to a range of their reproductive capacity. Most will argue that this particular knowledge is female and feminine. But midwives and their advocates often hesitate to call their movement feminist. Second, by 2019, midwifery organizations, especially at the national meetings and within national organizations, were using gender-inclusive language and widening the scope of practice and duty of care of midwives to include all people who labor and deliver, in a way that is an important corrective to hegemonic feminism that is woman-body-focused. The third caution relates specifically to rights consciousness as missing from the articulated legal consciousness of midwives and their advocates. Indeed, midwives and their advocates in the United States mobilize law, often without mobilizing rights. They engage in lobbying and social movement activism, frequently while declaring their cause apolitical. Their considerable success brings them more fully into the state's regulatory gaze, a goal they might personally abhor, even while the regulation often fails to fulfill the transformational promise offered by professional status. Midwives and their advocates rely on particular expressions of legal ideology and relationships to state power because of their understanding of the dominance of the state in regard to women's reproductive choices. Advocates pursue goals of professionalization, legalization, and regulation, even when their individual views of the state and its power understand that response to be a limit on freedom to practice and attend birth. At times, state law appears hegemonic. As much as they may wish to avoid it, midwives and their advocates encounter the state when it prosecutes midwives for attending birth, when they advocate for licensure and regulation, and when they suffer the law's failed implementation by running up against regulations meant to constrain access to some forms of reproductive care and some ways of transmitting knowledge about reproductive health and autonomy. Their advocacy opens space for a new cultural politics of birth, one that often explicitly seeks to transform the relationships of women, midwives, and families to state power. The institutions within which midwives and their advocates are located shape access to different framings of law and politics, and provide opportunities and constraints related to legal consciousness and legal mobilization. Even as midwives and their advocates adopt a language of professionalization in order to achieve legality, they do so, as the legal mobilization literature would predict, with an eye toward the potential drawbacks and certain limits of such a strategy. This ability to mobilize in multiple and simultaneous ways is rooted in a legal consciousness that is constitutively developed and expressed through their daily lived experiences as midwives, mothers, people who give birth, and consumers. As they come up against failed and limiting implementation of laws meant to enable their access and practice, their common sense understandings both become and reinforce legal knowledge through a process of legal consciousness building. The legal consciousness literature helps us understand the wide range of legal mobilization tactics used by movement activists, including mobilization tactics undertaken in the face of the limits of law and the persistence of injustice. This is particularly important for midwives, who are often failed by the implementation of the laws they most seek, yet understand legalizing their professional status to be essential to providing care to families. Legal implementation of potentially transformational law. Existing socio-legal scholarship is clear that there are often difficulties in implementing potentially transformational law, those laws that challenge or contradict social norms. In particular, a review of the literature shows that those laws meant specifically to protect and serve woman-identifying people, and especially to serve them in accessing their reproductive and sexual autonomy, often fail. These findings feel especially important when we look at the flawed implementation of laws that decriminalize and regulate midwifery care. Laws meant to help increase access for women to a woman-dominated profession in the service of their reproductive autonomy often failed to live up to their transformational promise. Even in states where their practice has been legal for a relatively long period of time, home birth midwives report that they are or feel illegal in some of what they do. In some jurisdictions, woman and baby-serving practices, like stitching tears, using Pitocin to stop a hemorrhage, and carrying oxygen, are construed as illegal and against the rules. In other places, midwives wrongly believe that they are required to have liability or malpractice insurance. They mistakenly but absolutely believe that they must have a collaborating physician or hospital practice agreement. They may be unable to find labs willing to run the blood work associated with prenatal care. And in even the most legal of legal states, midwives and their clients report social disapprobation of their choice to attend and deliver at home. They face harassment from doctors and nurses during emergency transfer situations, as well as family members who call child protective services when they disagree with the safety of an out-of-hospital option. Just as women continue to seek rights and access law, even as they recognize the limits of those laws for full protection and autonomy, the flawed implementation of regulations meant to safeguard midwifery has not dampened advocates' enthusiasm for legal mobilization. Flawed implementation has, though, contributed to their increased work to change the cultures of birth in their locales. My research clearly shows that achieving greater access to physiological birth requires political and legal mobilization, certainly. It also requires changing the narrative around birth in the United States, often through cultural practices meant to change norms and ideas. In fact, this book demonstrates that when state-level pro-midwifery advocates engage in legal mobilization and political movement building, three things inform their activism: their individual and collective view and understanding of law and politics, their particular strategic interactions and opportunities, and the way that the laws on the books have been implemented to date. These factors operate constitutively to close and open particular pathways for success, yet they are all embedded within imperatives to commodification of services, regulation of practice, and accreditation of educational pathways. They are further embedded within patriarchal structures of power that dismiss women's ways of knowing and traditional ways of disseminating knowledge, causing further harm to the radicalized bodies of women of color. Alternative and simultaneous narratives of midwifery and advocacy can be found in the reproductive justice movement, lawyering on behalf of victims of obstetric harm, the voices of midwives who refuse licensure, as well as manifestos and direct action by birth anarchists, radical doulas, and full-spectrum midwives who articulate even more sweeping claims to reproductive autonomy. Their assertions are not distinct from calls for professionalization. Rather, they are simultaneous with them and often articulated in spaces that overlap by individuals whose perspectives are fluid. For many activists and practitioners, the goal, access to quality midwifery care and a viable practice, is far more important than the means by which it is achieved. Legal, political, and cultural mobilization share equal importance, are pursued simultaneously, and are often inseparable. Methods, stories, and knowledge. This book is the culmination of 14 years of research funded at various stages by the American Political Science Association, the Iowa State Historical Society, Drake University's Center for the Humanities, Drake University's College of Arts and Sciences, and the National Science Foundation. My research initially focused on identifying and understanding the different regulatory environments for midwifery and activism, and was located primarily in three states while being contextualized within the national movement of midwifery advocates. Using triangulation via mixed methods for data collection, my research included collection and analysis of state politics and the legislative record, trial transcripts and legal briefs, and journalistic coverage of home birth midwifery prosecutions and midwifery activism. My primary methods, though, were participant observation, ethnographic fieldwork, formal, semi-structured interviews, long and unstructured conversations, and online interaction via email lists, Facebook, and Twitter. I chose to focus on Iowa, South Dakota, and Missouri. I'd moved from California to Iowa in 2006 and chose those three states to study because their legal status for midwifery was different from California's, where I'd begun my work in 2004. In my three primary field sites, I interviewed CNMs, CPMs, and uncredentialed midwives, as well as consumer advocates and lobbyists, both before and after legalization. I also interviewed midwives and activists from Alabama, legal in 2018, Michigan, legal in 2017, and California, legal since 1992. My informed opinion, based on the research I have read on birth outcomes and experiences, is that out-of-hospital birth in a low-risk situation is as safe as, if not safer than, in-hospital birth, and that the safety of such a birth is improved with better integration of care. In many instances, but not all, integration of care happens when CPMs are legal and regulated. Whether regulated or not, out-of-hospital birth is safer when attended by a trained and skilled practitioner. Though I have considerable concern about the loss of traditional and lay knowledge that comes with the certification, legalization, and regulation of a practice like midwifery, those issues are largely philosophical and pale in comparison to the stated desires of families and midwives alike for regulated and legal practice. These concerns also pale in comparison to the preponderance of the public health data. When some families will choose out-of-hospital birth, no matter what other options they have, it makes sense to me to help them have access to licensed and regulated midwives. Therefore, I was happy to engage in participant observation for this research in several contexts. In Iowa, I participated as a bill drafter and citizen activist in the several iterations of a bill to legalize and regulate CPMs, and as a member and co-leader of Friends of Iowa Midwives, later called Iowa Birth under different leadership. I also wrote a scholarly article on the history of the first birth center in the state using archival and interview data. In South Dakota, I spoke at the 2009 conference organized by South Dakota Safe Childbirth Options, now called South Dakota Birth Matters, attended several SDSCO organizing events, and consulted on film and video scripts for the group. And I wrote an early methodology piece on the difficulties and pleasures of doing research on people I considered friends, as well as people whose professional identities are illegal. In Missouri, I participated and observed while attending pro-midwifery rallies in the state organized by Friends of Missouri Midwives. Midwifery status in primary research locales. State, Alabama. Status, legal, unregulated. Route to status? Legislative process following highly publicized successful obstetric harm suit. State, California. Status, legal, regulated. Route to status? Legislative process. State, Iowa. Status, illegal, unregulated. Route to status? State, Michigan. Status, legal, regulation to come. Route to status, legislative process, judicial reaffirmation. State, Missouri. Status, legal, unregulated. Route to status, legislative process, judicial reaffirmation. State, South Dakota. Status, legal, regulated. Route to status, legislative process. I used a multiple case study methodology to organize my research, interpretation, and thinking about these sites. Though the research design itself was not explicitly comparative, the findings do invite and facilitate comparison. Sociolegal research routinely uses case study methodology to uncover legal mobilization strategies as well as the impacts of regulatory implementation. Leading scholars in the field have recently advocated that comparative methods be utilized for mobilization studies in particular, arguing that studying law and social movements comparatively and cross-nationally, across time, place, and cause, will enable researchers to investigate the variable conditions that give rise to, sustain, and impact legal and political reform efforts. The research I conducted investigated perceptions and attitudes during periods of regulatory transition and legal change leading to newly implemented policies. As midwifery regulation is changing rapidly at the state level, this research enables a view of recent legalization, actively prosecuted criminalization, and the absence of law in locales where certified professional midwifery is unregulated despite well-coordinated activist efforts for regulation toward licensure. This research also enabled an up-close view of how these new regulatory environments were impacting midwives and consumers. And, through it, I was provided a focused perspective on how they talked about seeking legal status, mobilizing for political action, and avoiding the state's regulatory gaze, all while attending to people who were laboring and delivering. I also conducted research in several national venues for midwives and their advocates. I attended the Big Push Summit in 2009 in Birmingham, Alabama, both as a researcher and as a state activist for Iowa. I have participated in the Big Push email list since then in both capacities. I attended the Midwives Alliance of North America conference in 2015 in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and a pre-conference workshop on pro-midwifery activism facilitated by Geraldine Simkins, as well as the entire program of the 2016 Midwives Alliance of North America, MANA, conference in Atlanta, Georgia. My research assistant, Jamie Wall Hanna, attended the 2017 MANA conference in Long Beach, California, on my behalf. I was present for the first Birth Keepers Summit, Berkeley, California, 2015, as well as the inaugural meeting of the Birth Rights Bar Association in Chicago in 2018, where I presented parts of this manuscript as a work in progress. I also participated in a multidisciplinary research collaborative headed by Dr. Saraswati Vedam at the University of British Columbia, which produced, in 2018, both a website that maps integration of care and outcomes across a range of geographic, legal, and demographic factors, and an article that was published in Plus One. Through this research, I have amassed more than 1,200 pages of field notes, completed 50 hours of formal interviews with 16 midwives and pro-midwifery activists, and spent hundreds of hours in well-documented conversations with these participants and dozens of others. 16 formal interviews feels a small number, until one remembers that the states I focused on denied practitioners legal status until quite recently, and the population of midwives in each state was exceptionally small. There were 2 lay midwives practicing openly in South Dakota when I began this work, 4 that I was aware of in Iowa, and an estimated 10 in Missouri. Each state had an activist corps of around 3 to 5 women and men, and 1 or 2 doctors in each state provided valuable assistance to pro-midwifery groups. Out of a universe of 30 or so potential interviewees, I accomplished 50%, with additional wide-ranging and long-winded conversations among those I did not formally interview. I consulted dozens of sources, including journalistic accounts of midwifery practice and prosecution, amicus briefs and court decisions, midwives' narratives of their professional lives and callings, and historical accounts of midwifery, medicine, and gynecology. The approach I have taken to analyzing these texts, notes, and interviews has been interpretive. Interpretive methods of data analysis are marked by close observation undertaken in order to explain complex social phenomena with a focus on the contexts within which those phenomena are embedded. I am not seeking to predict which states will pass bills, when, why, or how, though I have gotten good at guessing, nor to predict what will happen to lay midwives or CPMs once professionalization happens. Nor am I working to diagnose problems in movement strategies. Rather, I am interested in the ways that midwives and their advocates articulate their priorities and strategies, the ways that they report that their practices have been impacted by legalization efforts, and how those things relate to the enduring power of law and legality. While interpretive methods do not focus on making predictions, and interpretive data often are not useful for generalization, reflective and interpretive methods do lend themselves to hermeneutic and phenomenological understandings of particular organizations and movements, while contributing to theory building within the disciplines. Interpretive methods alert socio-legal researchers to the contingent, variable, and interdependent relationships among law, practice, consciousness, and mobilization. We can use interpretive methods to write a story that turns accidents into a well-plotted moral tale, rather than merely offering an account of just one thing after another. We can use interpretive method to construct a narrative that answers some of these questions. How do the pieces make up a whole? Does the law work the same way? What are the stable, recurrent, and consequential patterns of action, if not law on the books, written in the cases, statutes, and regulations? So, throughout this book, my presentation and analysis of the data I collected relies on, hinges on, takes the form of a story. I take to heart the work of sociolegal scholars who highlight the power of narratives and stories to both reinforce and undermine hegemonic tales told by and about law. A focus on lived experience of law in average people's everyday realities often entails a focus on the stories they tell and the stories we reconstruct about their lives. As Susan Silby writes, Any one person tells different stories of law. Legality is constructed from cultural tropes and memes circulating within the events of everyday life. And indeed, the very durability of law in legal institutions derives directly from the multiplicity of citizen interests and narratives inscribed in the law. As a piece of feminist scholarship, this book also takes seriously the insights gained from feminist, critical race, and womanist political theory regarding the power of story and auto-ethnographic accounts in consciousness raising, activism, and understanding. Scholars working within a reproductive justice frame understand, as Ricky Solinger writes in her History of Pregnancy in the United States, that sex and pregnancy is more than a biological event. Rather, sex and pregnancy is comprised of a set of cultural, social, and political signs to be promulgated through story, interpreted through narrative, and focused on as a lens through which women's emancipation can occur. As such, story and narrative are essential elements of reproductive justice activism and scholarly framing. Given my intellectual and normative commitments to feminist scholarship, reproductive justice, socio-legal scholarship, and interpretive methodologies, it is only fitting that this book, in fact, is full of stories. I also retell these stories because, quite simply,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.